You're listening to Podcast 22 in the Clean series on the man reanimated by Elisha's bones. In this sub-series of 10 lessons, the first two were reanimations of boys. Today's is short. Actually, it's very different to all the others and unusual. The account spans a mere 2 verses. We don't know anything about the sadness leading up to the man's death or the rejoicing that might have followed. He could have been an old man full of years who was buried, or maybe he was just a youth. The passage doesn't say. Elisha, who brought about the second reanimation in the Bible, which we looked at in the last lesson, Elisha's long dead, yet he plays a crucial role in the unexpected and radical reversal of what would otherwise have been a routine burial. In fact, this miracle almost feels like it shouldn't be in the Bible, like a legend, so strange it is. Let's read our text, which is 2 Kings 13, 20 and 21. So Elisha died, and they buried him. Now, bands of Moabites used to invade the land in the spring of the year. And as a man was being buried, behold, a marauding band was seen, and the man was thrown into the grave of Elisha. And as soon as the man touched the bones of Elisha, he revived and stood on his feet. Well, due to circumstances, there was no time to put his body in the family gravesite, or wherever they would have put it. To save time, they decide to double up, to dump the load and run. And when they hastily deposit his corpse, it comes into contact with Elisha's bones. Now, this may sound extra strange to those in Western culture, because Elisha wasn't buried in a coffin. This time, people were normally wrapped up in burial clothes. Well, even think of 800 years later, Lazarus. He's in a tomb, but he's wrapped up in burial clothes. So it may have been in his family burial chamber. Whether Elisha's body had totally decomposed or not, it is unknown. I mean, you'd think the burial might have been taking some time after Elisha's burial, period of years, for the bones to be ready. But there's no need to believe that his literal bones were what touched the man, as though Elisha was long dead. In 1 Kings 13, the old prophet of Bethel, referring to his own death and burial, requested, "Lay my bones beside his bones." He certainly wasn't asking to delay his burial until the soft parts of his body had all disappeared. What happens? The corpse comes into contact with Elisha. The corpse is reanimated. And maybe we may be tempted, because it's such a short passage, to seek some novel explanation. Or maybe to make the account more sensational than it is already. But we don't need to do that. We don't need to say, well, the man got up on his feet, and he was coming to attention in the presence of Elisha, reporting for duty as the Moabite skirmishes or the Syrian war dragged on. Now, and it's also doubtful that he was raised from the dead in order to scare away the Moabites, which I've also read. Of course, it's possible that they pursued his buriers, the family, and realized this guy was in grave clothes, but we'd read nothing of it. There's not a hint of speculation about what went on, what was said, or how the man lived out the rest of his natural life. God's power was still working through the prophet Elisha. We should be alert to the parallels. There are miraculous parallels in the lives of Elijah and his understudy, Elisha. With both, we find miracles in association with the end, the final end of their ministry, the time they depart this world. Elijah ascends in a chariot of fire. Elisha's bones revivify a corpse hastily, temporarily placed in his burial spot. In the previous section, the verses right before our passage, 2 Kings 13, Elisha calls the national leaders to faith before he himself dies and is buried. There's no prophet of God in Israel at that time, if I read it correctly, once Elisha is gone. All they have is, well, the dead bones of Elisha. And although there may have been no prophet in Israel, God's power was still available, always available. It's as though to say, I'm still here, trust me. Because the death of the messenger hardly undoes the message. Elisha's influence continues to benefit the nation. And one more thing. Touching a dead man's bones made one unclean. That's in the law and the Torah. But not in this case. It's more the opposite. This hapless fellow wasn't contaminated when he came into contact with the corpse. He himself was a corpse, after all. But he was infused with life by touching Elisha's bones. Elisha's bones didn't make him unclean. They gave him a second chance. Application is simple. There's good news. Death does not have the final word. Thus, we have permission to have mixed feelings when a loved one dies. There's something after. It's not the very end. Death does not have the final word. Secondly, in the case of some, their influence will continue after their death, as with Elisha. That influence may, in fact, continue long after they've passed away. And three, even when times are dark, God's power is still available. Don't give up. Trust, pray, lean on Him.